first contingent of Marines to depart from Lebanon embarks on landing ships at a Beirut beach, almost a month after the landings that electrified the world. About 1,700 Lebanese are moving out, just over a tenth of the 15,000 American troops that will move into Lebanon at the request of the government. Lebanon's presidential election has come and gone, but no official request for troop withdrawal has been made. And the effect of this move is uncertain. The rebels, still under arms, see it as a token gesture. Pro-government forces would like to see the Marines stay. President-elect Shihab kept silence. Washington attributes no significance to the move. From one source, an unqualified, favorable reaction. From 1,700 Marines, relieved of an assignment that brought them no excitement, but plenty of trouble, worry, hard work, and red tape. 10,000 tons of American wheat arrive at Aqaba, Jordan's only port. One of a series of emergency shipments to relieve the chronic shortages of food in that beleaguered kingdom. Its borders with Israel and Nasser's violently hostile United Arab Republic are effectively sealed off. Only American economic aid and British assistance in the form of military and monetary aid have enabled Jordan to survive so far. Pending a unified economic program for Jordan and all the Middle East, King Hussein's nation lives literally from day to day, isolated and wholly dependent on the West for its independence and survival. Submarine Nautilus receives a gala harbor welcome as she sails into Portland, England, completing an 8,100-mile, 21-day voyage from Honolulu across the top of the world under the North Pole. For the event, her skipper returned by air from Washington, where he'd been flown immediately after the Nautilus emerged from under the Arctic ice cap. After 96 hours under the ice, the nuclear-powered sub surfaced within 10 miles of a preset target point, an incredible feat of navigation. Adding to the excitement of her arrival was news that another atomic sub, the Skate, had also cruised under the pole, and that the Seawolf, a third, was cruising in the Arctic. But the glory of the first subpolar transit belongs to Commander William Anderson and his 116-man crew, well deserving of the Presidential Unit Citation for pioneering a new sea lane across the top of the world.